Subnetting and supernetting in classful addressing did not really solve the address depletion problem and made the distribution of addresses and the routing process more difficult. With the growth of the internet, a larger address space was needed as a long-term solution. The larger address space, however, requires that the length of IP addresses to be increased, which means the format of IP packets needs to be changed. Although the long-range solution has already been devised and is called IPv6, short-term solution was also devised to use the same address space but to change the distribution of addresses to provide a fair share to each organization. The short-term solution still uses IPv4 addresses, but it is called classless addressing. In 1996, the internet authorities announced a new architecture called classless addressing. In classless addressing, variable length blocks are used that belong to no classes. We can have a block of one address, two addresses, four addresses, 128 addresses, and so on. In classful addressing, the whole address space was divided into five classes. In classless addressing, the whole address space is divided into variable length blocks. Theoretically, we can have a block of 2 raised to 0, 2 raised to 1, 2 raised to 2, and up to 2 raised to 32 addresses. The only restriction is that the number of addresses in the block needs to be a power of 2. Two-level addressing. In classful addressing, two-level addressing was provided by dividing an address into net ID and host ID. The net ID defined the network and the host ID defined the host in the network. The same idea can be applied in classless addressing. When an organization is granted a block of addresses, the block is actually divided into two parts, the prefix and the suffix. The prefix plays the same role as the net ID, and the suffix plays the same role as the host ID. All addresses in the block have the same prefix. Each address has a different suffix. Figure shows the prefix and suffix in a classless block. In classful addressing, the length of net ID, N, depends on the class of addresses. It can be only 8, 16, or 24. In classless addressing, the length of prefix N depends on the size of the block. It can be 0, 1, 2, 3, up to 32. In classless addressing, the value of N is referred to as prefix length, whereas the value of 32 minus N is referred to as suffix length. Slash notation. The net ID length in classful addressing or the prefix length in classless addressing play a very important role when we need to extract the information about the block from a given address in the block. However, there is a difference here in classful and classless addressing. In classful addressing, the net ID length is inherent in the address. Given an address, we know the class of the address that allows us to find the net ID length. It may 8, 16 or 24. Whereas in classless addressing, the prefix length cannot be found if we are given only an address in the block. The given address can belong to a block with any prefix length. In classless addressing, we need to include the prefix length to each address if we need to find the block of the address. In this case, the prefix length n is added to the address separated by slash. The notation is informally referred to as slash notation. An address in classless addressing can be represented as shown in figure. The slash notation is formally referred to as a classless inter-domain routing or CIDR notation. Network mask. The idea of network mask in classless addressing is the same as the one of classful addressing. A network mask is a 32-bit number with the n leftmost bits all set to zeros and the rest of the bits all set to ones. Extracting block information. An address in slash notation, that is CIDR, contains all information we need about the block. The first address, that is network address, the number of addresses and the last address. These three pieces of information can be found as: 1. The number of addresses in the block can be found as capital N is equal to 2 raised to 32 minus N, in which N is the prefix length and capital N is the number of addresses in the block. Second, the first address, that is network address, in the block can be found by ANDing the address with the network mask. That means first address is equal to any address and network mask. Alternatively, we can keep the n leftmost bits of any address in the block and set the 32 minus n bits to zeros to find the first address. And third is, the last address in the block can be found by either adding the first address with the number of addresses or directly by ORing the address with the complement, that is NOTing, of the network mask. That means last address is equal to any address or complement of network mask. Alternatively, we can keep the n leftmost bits of any address in the block and set the 32 minus n bits to ones to find the last address. Block allocation. The ultimate responsibility of block allocation is given to a global authority called the Internet Corporation for assigned names and addresses, that is ICANN. However, ICANN does not normally allocate addresses to individual internet users. It assigns large block of addresses to an ISP or a larger organization that is considered as ISP in this case. For proper operation of CIDR, three restrictions need to be applied to the allocated block. 1. The number of requested addresses, that is capital N, needs to be a power of 2. This is needed to provide an integer value for the prefix length, that is N. The number of addresses can be 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, and so on. Second, the value of prefix length can be found from the number of addresses in the block. Since capital N is equal to 2 raised to 32 minus N, then N is equal to log to base 2 into bracket 2 raised to 32 divided by capital N bracket complete is equal to 32 minus log to base 2 capital N. That is the reason why capital N needs to be a power of 2. Third, the requested block needs to be allocated where there are a contiguous number of unallocated addresses in the address space. However, there is a restriction on choosing the beginning addresses of the block. The beginning address needs to be divisible by the number of addresses in the block. To see this restriction, we can show that the beginning address can be calculated as x into 2 raised to n minus 32, in which x is the decimal value of prefix. In other words, the beginning address is x into n. Relation to classful addressing. All issues discussed for classless addressing can be applied to classful addressing. As a matter of fact, classful addressing is a special case of classless addressing in which the blocks in class A, B, and C have the prefix length NA is equal to 8, NB is equal to 16, NC is equal to 24. A block in classful addressing can be easily changed to a block in class addressing if we use the prefix length defined in table. Subnetting. Three levels of hierarchy can be created using subnetting. An organization that is granted a range of addresses may divide the range into several subranges and assign each subrange to a subnetwork or subnet. A subnetwork can be divided into several sub-subnetworks. A sub-subnetwork can be divided into several sub-sub-subnetworks and so on. Designing subnets. The subnetworks in a network should be carefully designed to enable the routing of packets. We assume the total number of addresses granted to the organization is capital N. The prefix length is small n. The assigned number of addresses to each subnetwork is capital N sub. The prefix length for each subnetwork is small n sub. And the total number of subnetworks is small s. Then the few steps need to be carefully followed to guarantee the proper operation of subnetworks. 1. The number of addresses in each subnetwork should be a power of 2. 2. The prefix length for each subnetwork should be found using the formula small n sub is equal to small n plus log to base 2 into bracket capital N divided by capital N sub bracket complete. And 3. Is the starting address in each subnetwork should be divisible by the number of addresses in that subnetwork. This can be achieved if we first assign addresses to larger networks. Finding information about each subnetwork. After designing the subnetworks, the information about each subnetwork, such as first and last address, can be found using the process we described to find the information about each network in the internet. Address aggregation. One of the advantages of CIDR architecture is address aggregation. ICANN assigns a large block of addresses to an ISP. Each ISP in turn divides its assigned block into smaller sublocks and grants the sublocks to its customer. Many blocks of addresses are aggregated in one block and granted to one ISP. Special addresses. In classful addressing, some addresses were reserved for special purposes. The classless addressing scheme inherits some of these special addresses from classful addressing. Special blocks. Some blocks of addresses are reserved for special purposes. All zeros address. The block 0.0.0.0/32, which contains only one single address, is reserved for communication when a host needs to send an IPv4 packet but it does not know its own address. This is normally used by a host at bootstrap time when it does not know its IPv4 address. The host sends an IPv4 packet to a bootstrap server called DHCP server. Using this address as the source address and a limited broadcast address as the destination address to find its own address. All ones address, that is limited broadcast address. The block 255.255.255.255/32, which contains one single address and is reserved for limited broadcast address in the current network. A host that wants to send a message to every other host can use this address as a destination address in IPv4 packet. However, a router will block a packet having this type of address to confine the broadcasting to the local network. In the figure, a host sends a datagram using a destination IPv4 address consisting of all ones. All devices on this network receive and process this datagram. Loopback addresses. A block 127.0.0.0/8 is used for the loopback address, which is an address used to test the software on a machine. When this address is used, a packet never leaves the machine. It simply returns to the protocol software. It can be used to test the IPv4 software. For example, an application such as ping can send a packet with a loopback address as the destination address to see if the IPv4 software is capable of receiving and processing a packet. Note that this can be used only as a destination address in an IPv4 packet. Private addresses. A number of blocks are assigned for private use. They are not recognized globally. These blocks are depicted in table. These addresses are used either in isolation or in connection with network address translation technique. Multicast addresses. The block 224.0.0.0/4 is reserved for multicast communication. Special addresses in each block. It is not mandatory, but it is recommended that some addresses in a block be used for special addresses. These addresses are not assigned to any host. However, if a block or sub-block is so small, we cannot afford to use part of the addresses as special addresses. Network address. The first address with the suffix set all to zeros in a block defines the network address. It actually defines the network itself and not any host in the network. Of course, the first address in a subnetwork is called the subnetwork address and plays the same role. Direct broadcast address. The last address in a block or a sub-block with the suffix set all to zeros, sorry, all to ones, can be used as a direct broadcast address. This address is usually used by a router to send a packet to all hosts in a specific network. All hosts will accept a packet having this type of destination address. Note that this address can be used only as a destination address in an IPv4 packet.